The verse I want to speak to you today is Romans 15, 13. Romans 15, 13. I don't think I will have to belabor this point much because, again, once you read the verse, I think you will have gotten God's point. And if you didn't, well, let me tell it to you again. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound. Can you say abound? Can you say abound a little louder?
Abound.
We're not going level. We're not average. We're not just enough. We're talking about abounding. We're talking about exceeding. We're talking about excessive. We're not talking about momentary. We're talking about abounding. I don't know if you want enough money or you want abound money, but I think I would go with the abound. I don't know if you want enough food or you want a little abound in food today. I'm not sure where you are. I don't know if you want a little joy or you want to abound in joy, but I'm going to go with the abounding. You want a little peace or you want to abound in peace. He says God's going to work that you may abound in hope. Why? Can you tell me why? It's by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what that says to me immediately. You can hear it all you want to. You can even mentally assess it all you want to. But if you think you can grab a hold of this by your own two hands, physical or otherwise, you cannot. But if you will let the Holy Spirit do the Holy Spirit's work, then I'm going to tell you, God, the very God of the universe, is the very God of hope that's got something for you this very day. Father, we just come to you and thank you for who we serve. We serve an almighty God that loves his people. You are not neutral about us. You love us. You are fighting for us. You are with us, and you will take down the devil himself to give us entrance into heaven itself. Thank you, O God, that your great love is present in this day, in this service, in this sanctuary. So God, may we receive the word of God as not simply an opinion, but as truth. May we hear the Spirit's voice not as an option, but as a necessity. And oh God, may your Spirit do all he wants to do in us today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. With that one verse, I want to tell you a story that comes out of Acts chapter 27, because in this wonderful verse, we have a prayer, we have a blessing, we have, in some ways, a spiritual desire lived out in a spiritual act, which is a good thing. What we receive here today, we ought to live this coming week. Thank you, Mama. I got one amener. We ought to live what we hear today. If you're discouraged, plenty of altar for you. If you're down, there's plenty of people to pray for you. The word of God has been shared and it's still being shared. You ought to live what you hear today. It's not for here. It's for the life. So Paul says this in Romans many years before Acts chapter 27. But what he said as a blessing in Romans 15 to a church he had never met, he lived out in Acts chapter 27. And the reason why we need both of those is because it's like a good sermon title I heard just this past week. The sermon title was, of course, it's of course over dramatic, but the sermon title was How to Love a Vampire. Alright, what does that mean? Okay, let me translate it for you. How to love somebody who sucks the life out of you. Find more application with that. Okay, maybe it's a job that sucks the life out of you. Maybe it is a relationship that sucks the life out of you. Maybe it's your circumstance. Maybe it's your physical well-being. Something may be right now sucking the very life out of you. Trouble tends to do that. Life tends to do that to us. We need help in this world because tempests arise. Tempests surround us and threaten to drive us to despair. That takes us to Acts chapter 27. In Acts chapter 27, Paul is with these gentlemen, actually they're guards, going on a ship to Rome. He is going to be on trial in Rome for being a Christian, for standing up for Jesus Christ. I simply want to frame this as the tempest. I don't want to get into the details of it. You can read it for yourself. Know the story. You probably know the story well. Acts 27:20. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest beat on us, all hope on that ship that we would be saved was finally gone. Have you been there, church? You might be there now. A tempest takes you to the place of such battering and beating and unknown that all hope for getting out of it has been given up. It's a bad place to be without hope. It's a bad place, a dark place where you despair. Now, we don't typically share those, but they're real places. They're hard places. And they not only happen to the unrighteous, oh boy, they happen to the righteous too. They happen to us. Tempests, storms engulf us. And what that reveals, because I'm here to tell you, God allows these things. When Paul, his apostle, is on a ship heading toward Rome where he's called him to, and a storm comes up on the Mediterranean, God's not saying, oh, didn't see that one coming. God knew. God had a plan. And the storm was the midst of his plan. What these tempests do is they show us where our hope lies. We can say, oh, I believe and I trust in Jesus. Your life will show you whether you do or not. What it takes to bring you to despair will show you where your hope truly lies in. And this is an interesting story because Paul says, if you'll recall, as they're fixing to try to get around the island of Cyprus to winter in a better port, he says, we ought not do this. We shouldn't do this. So he knew in his spirit, we ought not do this. But how many of you know the world is not listening to the Spirit of God? We're like a lone Paul who's got shackles around us. And we say, we ought not go on this trip. And the sailors and the experts and the owners are saying, you're crazy. You don't know what you're talking about. We know better. You read the story. They got together. They had a meeting. And when they brought their heads together, they said, we know best. We're going up the island. The owner says, I got financial stock in this. I know best. We're going up the island. But they knew that the soldier left them to their devices and said, this is what we think. Sailors, we think we can handle this. We're just going up a little ways up the coast. We can handle this. And what is interesting to me is they never asked their gods for help. I think that's telling. Obviously, though there were a multitude of gods in the Roman Empire, what did they really do? Not much of nothing. You sacrificed to them and you pray they did something, but you didn't really expect them to do anything. They didn't ask Zeus or whoever was the Poseidon, the god of the sea, could you please give us safe passage and we'll give you our offerings. No, the soldier and the sailors and the owners, they got together and decided what was best. They thought, we can handle this. And they even knew the storms that could come up. They name it here in the passage. Euroclydon, a northeast wind that is a tempest type of wind that'll just batter you and beat you. It was coming on the Mediterranean, but we can handle it. You know what that says to me? It says to me that the gods who were not really gods, as Paul said, they didn't hear, they didn't listen, they didn't speak. The gods were really a projection of the people's own feelings. They thought, I'm a Roman soldier, I know better. I'm a sailor, I know better. I'm an owner. I know better. I know these seas. I understand the science of my day. I got it. We've got this under control. How many of you know they didn't have it under control? The one non-sailor, non-professional, non-soldier, Christian prisoner had it right all along. They just didn't know how to listen to the one God that was speaking to the one that would listen to him. You know, that tells us in our world today, there's a whole lot of scientists that say we know best. You just listen to us. Because we understand everything, but for all they understand, stuff's still happening they don't predict. They still don't have a handle on it. And if you put your hope in that, you're going to be disappointed. Some people are disappointed that the ice caps hadn't melted yet because they already predicted it several times. It just hadn't happened. They're not quite right. Sailors, professionals, they get it wrong. I think it's funny. You know, out of all the great boat attractions that there are in this world, one of the most famous around here is the Titanic. I just think that's so funny. We can't brag about our great successes, what the great attraction is, if the professionals fail. Why? Because if our hope is in man, how many of you know already, man will let you down. They can tell you, I'm 100% right. They're not 100% right. We hear every 4 years promises of healing oceans and everything's going to be great again. Hello, is it great yet? Is everything right yet? Is everything good yet? There are some broken promises that are littered every 4 years. And you know what they put on top of them? Just more promises. But if you put your hope in those promises, you're going to fail. You could put your hope ultimately where I think most Roman citizens, Greek citizens did. They put it in themselves. God's not answering, so I'm going to answer. There are no gods in this modern day, so I'm going to make my own choices. I'm going to trust in me. I'm going to depend on me. I know what's best for me. Really? Let's be honest. Have you ever let yourself down? Have you ever been disappointed in yourself? Have you ever said, why in this world did I do that? If you've ever asked that question, you know, I can't even put my hope in myself. The tempests come, the problems come, and I feel sorry for all medical professionals and all who are in those serious types of work. Somebody comes to them and they have to give them a diagnosis, so they have to give them a bottom line. You know what people so often say? Can you give me any hope? I don't want to be in that position. I really don't. God bless y'all who have to answer that question. Can you give me any hope? I'm here to tell you, our doctors and our nurses cannot give you hope. All they can do is tell you what they know according to your condition and the trends. That's all they can do. They can't give you hope. They can't. Nobody can. We get in tempest, and that's what we want so much, a way out, a hope, but it's not there. Just like these sailors, after days and days of being battered, you can't see the stars, so there's no navigation. All you see is water all around you, so the only thing you're thinking is, which part of this ocean am I going to die in? I can't go north, I can't go south, I don't even know where that is. All I'm doing is waiting to die, and the storm is battering you day after day after day, and you've done everything you can do, and you finally say, I can't handle it anymore, I give up. All hope has been abandoned. But let's go back to Paul's prayer. Paul says to the Romans, I pray the God of hope. See, there's another place of hope. There is another source of hope. And it's not in our professionals. It's not in our technology. It's not in who we are or what we have. There is a hope that resides in God. And he's praying for the God of hope to dispense joy and to dispense peace to those, read in Romans 15, who believe. Where do you put your hope? You put it in you? You put it in anywhere else? You will be disappointed. How about putting your hope in God? Because when you put your hope in God, Paul says to us that the God of hope will give you joy and give you peace. How's that possible? In hope, just all about pie in the sky and the sweet by and by. That's simplistic. God came that we may have eternal life. I don't argue with you at all. And I know a lot of you think that's just eternity. But that is a part of it. My eternity is settled. It's done. I don't have to worry about that today. I don't have to worry about how it's going to turn out. That's already been settled for me. But that's just not a sweet by and by issue. If I know it's settled then, it ought to do something for me now. If I don't have to worry about my life, then what I ought to do with this life? I ought to give it away. If my eternity is settled, then all I have to do is live in connection with the one who gives me life. In believing, joy comes. In believing, peace comes. Is that just theory? No, beloved. Let me take you back to that ship in Acts chapter 27. While the sailors are despairing, while the soldiers are despairing, it doesn't say it in the scriptures, but somebody's been talking to God. Somebody's been reaching out to somebody above the storm. Somebody's been saying, like that song, my hope is in Jesus. My hope is in the Lord. Well, how does Jesus help you in a storm? How does Jesus help you in a sinking boat? That doesn't make any sense. If I'm on the cross around Calvary, okay, but I'm in a boat in the middle of the Mediterranean, what in the world is Jesus going to do for me? Well, Paul said, I was in talking to God. I assume Paul's praying here. He said, God sent somebody to me. And probably the scriptures doesn't say it because this is not generated as Paul makes this happen. But God knew where Paul was. He knew his condition, and he knew that everybody else on that ship had disobeyed him but Paul. Now how does God go work all that mess out? You got all them dozens of disobedient people and one faithful. And what in the world's God going to do? God says, angel, you've got a message to send. The God of hope sent a message through his angel. Stood right beside Paul. I'll tell you what, we say we can't hear God in a storm. Jesus can sleep in a storm, and Paul can hear from God in a storm. Hello? Hello? Are you deaf? Can you not hear? Can you not see? Can you not rest? Can you not be at peace? We ought to learn how to handle storms, not try to avoid them. Because those in the Bible knew how to handle them. And Paul heard a message from God that says, don't be afraid. He says, my will is for you to be in Rome. And Rome is where you're going to, Paul. You won't get there on this ship, but you will survive this storm. You will get there. And I've given the life of every man on that ship to you. It's not because of their expertise they're going to live. It's because somebody has heard from heaven. Somebody's listening to God. And I grant their lives to you. Paul gets up in the middle of that ship. And he believes God. He trusts in God. He doesn't say this is wishful thinking. He says, I have a hope. I have a trust. There is a God whom I serve. And here's what he said to me. We are going to make it. Not in this ship. This ship's going to sink. We're going to make it. And every one of your lives is going to be preserved. And that's how he says it. The God whom I serve. I know you don't serve him. But I serve him. And we're going to see how that works out. When a child of God has the hope of God, then they can live at peace. Okay, well, how does that work out? He's still in a storm. They're still being battered by the waves. They're still worried about drowning. They still can't see the stars. And this tempest is still beseeching them. Paul says, you know what? I'm hungry. I think it's time for us to eat. We haven't eaten for 14 days. We're worried about dying. You're worried about eating. What did Paul pray? The God of hope will send you joy. He will send you peace. Well, doesn't that have to be outside of the storm? No, ma'am. No, sir. He'll send you peace in the storm. He'll send you joy in the storm. The same God that'll take you through a fire is the same God that'll take you through a storm. If he's a God of hope with the fires of Nebuchadnezzar, he is the God of hope in the storms of the Mediterranean. God, Paul takes out bread, and you know what he does? He doesn't start acting like those foolish Israelites of the past, just gobbling it up like a greedy monster. He bows his head and he gives thanks. Dear God, he gives thanks in the middle of the storm. He breaks the bread and says, have some. And you know what? They did. All of a sudden, they were encouraged. They received some. They began to eat, toss the food overboard, and hope was restored to that boat. What did Paul promise, though? What did Paul pray for the Romans? He said, I pray the God of hope will give you joy, will give you peace, and you will have an abundance of hope. So God is not only the source of hope, he's the giver of hope. How does that work? One scripture to share with you is from Romans 6:9. The faith that we have in Him, and I don't have time to get into all this today, but the faith we have in Him, it's an anchor, Hebrews says, that's tied beneath, behind the veil. It's anchored in the heavens, behind the veil, in the very presence of God. It says our hope as an anchor of the soul is sure and steadfast, and it's in the presence of God. How many of you know an anchor's got two ends? You understand that, don't you? Now, if the anchor's in God, where's the other end? It's in my heart. It's in your heart that believe. It's right here. I'm looking for an anchor in the world. You won't find it. I'm looking for an anchor in you. You won't find it. My anchor's in the heavens. My anchor's in Jesus. My anchor and my hope is in Him. And it holds me. And it gives me. It dispenses to me hope. Where do I get my hope from? T.B. and Grace are saying, all my hope is in Jesus. It comes down, and when it begins to bloom in my heart, it begins to grow. You see, the more I believe, the more it grows, and the more it expands, and the more I have an abundance of hope. Paul's point was bigger than this, and let's close. Bow your heads, please. Paul's message in Romans 15 is part of a larger passage. And he says, Jesus Christ came as a servant, true servant to Israel. He fulfilled all Jewish expectations. He was their hope fulfilled. But he said, God had something else in mind in Jesus. It wasn't that the Jews get in and everybody else is damned to futility and eventually hell. He says, no, Jesus Christ opened a way that in Jesus, even the Gentiles will find their hope. We can trust in Jesus. You Gentiles, you people who are people of the gods, people of reason, people of this world. You don't have the heritage. You don't have the depth of revelation that has been given to the Jews. You people, you can find your hope in Jesus. Now let me make one other clarification. I can't even tell you to put your hope in the church, because unfortunately the church will let you down too. It's full of people. But the God of the church, Jesus Christ, is your hope. So whatever tempest you're going through, it just showed you what you were trusting on. Well, I was trusting on this relationship to work out, and it's not. Well, I was trusting on this job to meet my needs, and it's not. Well, I was trusting that this was going to be better after I made this change or that change, and it's not. If you put your hope in the wrong things, you are going to be subject to despair. And I have to tell you, I've been there, church. I've known Jesus all my life, but I have the capacity to put my trust and faith in something I'm doing, in something I have, and I have been bitterly disappointed as in my own prayers, I say, God, I can't anymore. I give up. The only reason for my despair was because of where my hope lay. Now, God has spoken to you about hope today. Now, may I ask you to stand?